You listen to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Oh, I don't mute. I don't know how to do that. With that being said, welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. For those that are watching the video version, I think this may be the third episode in the row where I'm wearing the same t-shirt, but they have all been recorded on different days, and this has been washed in the interim, so don't worry about it. Everything smells fine here in the SWN Tower studio. On this edition, I am joined by a returning guest. Last time he was on was November 2022 for episode 176. And if all goes to plan, you're listening to episode 286. So it's been a long journey for both of us. Welcome back to the show, Retro Randy Valentine.
Thanks very much for having me, Billy. It's always a pleasure. I always enjoy getting a little catch up and chatting with you. I'm going to get rid of the sunglasses gimmicks. I only put them on because, you know, it might boost sales at the gimmick table. So, yeah. £5 at your nearest wrestling show where I'm appearing. But yeah, I'll get them off so I can see your handsome face. And I don't know, I can't smell you, but you look like you smell fine. So I wouldn't worry too much.
Well, I mean, it's according to my little screen here, it's 16 degrees and mostly cloudy up in Elgin. So, oh no, now our screens came up and I can't see you. There we go. Right, we're all okay. So yeah, it's been a hot and sweaty time up in Murray. I'm assuming it's the same down in other places down south, as we call it, from up in our ivory tower in the northeast. But yes, I'm excited to have a catch up because last time we planning to kind of do the whole story of Randy Valentine into Retro Randy Valentine, and we only got to the end of Randy Valentine, and then we had to leave it as a part two for the mystery of how you actually kind of got back to wrestling. I can't remember if we actually discussed your reasons for coming back. If we got that far. As we tangented just incredibly so often into other stories and things like that as we went. But no, I'm super excited. So just in general, how are you doing?
I'm doing absolutely fantastic. I'm doing brilliant. I'm loving life. I'm loving wrestling. It's a good feeling. It's a good place to be, physically, mentally, everything. It's just running really well just now, so it's good. It's really good. Really enjoying being back. I wish I'd went back and even just listened to the end of the last podcast, so I know where we left off. Because I don't know if we started on how I got back into things. But what do you think? Is that a good jumping on point?
I think so. Even if it's just folk that didn't. I think it was just about 2 hours we were last time, hour 40 or something. So even if we do like the old previously on Retro Randy Valentine, just to kick us off. But before I do that, this continuing my season 7 seems to be I got all the belts on this particular show on the season, and it continues with the FCW tag team title behind you, which we will speak about a little bit further later on. So yeah, we'll start with that as our wee jumping off point. Randy Valentine, he left the wrestling business, became a commentator, international broadcast analyst Darren T. Goss, and then eventually Retro Mania ran wild. So just briefly, how did you get back into the world of wrestling? Why did you come back?
It is 100% Johnny Lyon's fault. I had started going along to watch Fair City Wrestling shows. I'm trying to think which came first. I feel like I went along to see them. In fact, I did. Yes, it was a Bonner Hall show. As it was in Dundee, it was just on the doorstep. My wife and Kevin Williams' wife have been great friends for a long, long time. Godparent to one of his kids. Favourite auntie and uncle, I think it's, you know, safe to say, to both of his kids. So wanted to go along. I had no real interest in wrestling in the area, but thought, you know, this is a very different thing. This is a very different animal. I'm going to go along. It was quite an eventful night. There was some technical difficulties. There was some shenanigans. It was nice to see the roster rally. There was a few folk there. Caleb Valhalla was in the main event. I can't remember who he was in there with. There was a few other names there. I'm like, I know these guys. I'm friends with these guys. So it was, yeah, it was what seemed like it was going to be a good environment. It was a great environment. Reconnected with a few people that I hadn't spoken to for years. Ian Ambrose, it was great to reconnect with him and see where he was with things and how things had been going. And so, yeah, I started going along to the FCW shows regularly through Perth, through the Tulloch, which, fantastic atmosphere. It was the first thing that I thought. I was impressed with the show that Fair City Wrestling put on, more specifically that John Young would put together. Nice looking set, big screen, smoke machine, lighting, all these kind of things. I've always said, wrestling needs a little bit of smoke and mirrors. You can't just stick a ring in the middle of a hall and go, hey, wrestling. And to be honest, there are times the quality of the wrestling that's going on, the matches that are going on, they speak for themselves and they don't need the smoke and mirrors. They don't need all the show. But I always feel that it goes hand in hand with wrestling. You know, wrestling isn't just the competitive thing that's going on in the ring. It's the show that goes on around about it. You want to walk into a wrestling show and you want to go, ooh, this looks good. And I thought, going into an FCW show, this looks good. For what was, I'm going to say, clubby show, and I don't want anybody to take that as an offensive term, because I think that environment's fantastic. It's great to do big venues and all the rest of it, you know? Mm. That's the dream for, I think, every promoter. They want to be out there in front of thousands. But see, when you've got just that core couple of hundred and they love what you're doing and they love the show that they're seeing and you can feel that in the room, fantastic. So the atmosphere, straight away, got me hooked. The wrestling was great. The stories that were getting fed through, the effort that these guys were putting in was tremendous. But I was still just there as a fan, still just sitting there watching it, still there, spending time with nieces, with friends, with family. It was a social thing. And then I believe it was a match with Taylor Bryden, or it might have been Caleb. Can't remember which one it was. They had a surprise challenger for the title. And out comes Johnny Lyons, retired Johnny Lyons. It was Johnny time. And I had no idea, because I'm no interest in what's going on. So I'm like, oh, wow, you know, Coach Stu has got the spandex back on. It was great to see. It was great to see how energetic it was, how enthusiastic it was. They had this sort of, not saying another lease on life, you know, that's because he was very much involved with the coaching at PWA, now Power Pro. So he was still involved in wrestling. But to see him out there in front of a crowd, because Johnny's always been great at getting a crowd going. Mm-hmm. And I'm watching him, and all right, at that time, a little bit more around about the middle, hadn't been near a gym or anything like that, hadn't been in a ring for God knows how long. I'm thinking to myself, I think I could do that. I think I could do just a little something, just a little bit of nonsense. And they had a Rumble show coming up around the corner, the Fair City Rumble, which I think would have been October 2022, probably around that time. Recorded the last episode. So I just put out there, I said, what do you think? You know, you've got 30 guys out, well, you've got 29 really good wrestlers out there. You can afford to have me, you know. It's not going to stink up the place too badly. It did stink up the place a little bit, but come on. And it was like, yeah, you know what? Do it. Once I'd said I'll do it, then I thought, wait, I actually have to do it. Because I don't want to, I don't want to go out there and just be this. I don't want to be an excuse for the dads to go home and go, told you that wrestling was a load of shite, you know. And that's always been my goal, which again, come to later on, as we ramble off into the weeds. So I got in touch with Andy Wild Roberts down at FPWA. I said, Andy, I need to do something. I need to get back. I need to get back into ring shape. I was never in ring shape. You know, I was not great to begin
with. I remember 2012. You were ripped.
I was ripped off, but I was like, I'd go in and we'll get things going and we'll see how things can go, see if I can get some traction with the wheels on the ground. So went through, trained with Andy, was sparring with Craig, which was fantastic. I always have a soft spot for Craig for being there and helping me through those first sessions. Went down, trained up, got some reps in down there. I felt comfortable because it wasn't part of a regular. I thought, I can't just go and join a training session somewhere because I'm going to stick out like a sore thumb. I am going to be most likely at least 20 years older than anybody else that's there. I'm going to be out of shape. I'm going to be on that. I don't know how to talk to these young people. It's going to be a disaster. Do it behind closed doors. I think I might have a chance of it sticking. So it kind of did. I felt at least comfortable enough that I could go in and I could do a little bit in a rumble. And I'll be fine. So time came around for the rumble. I went in some homemade gear. It wasn't homemade. I'd ordered white tights. My idea was I was going to airbrush them, Rick Rude style.
Right.
But finding fabric paint that worked with the cheap little airbrush that I've got, that wasn't happening. So then they were hand painted. It was a pretty botched job. Didn't look great. Looked all right from a distance. Up close, terrible. I'll dig them out. I'll take a photo. I'll send it. You can put it up on the screen for folk to see and they'll go, oh, dear. It was Rick Rude inspired. I had tassels on the, not the boots, because I don't have wrestling boots. I had little ring boots, training boots, and the kick pads with the tassels around there. I think I had the t-shirt on, again, that I'd made myself. And out I went, big grin on my face. Got a bit of a pop, which was nice. You know, got a little bit, I was expecting to go out to crickets, but there was a little bit of a, I don't think it's because anybody knew who it was. I think it was just, I can't believe this guy's left the house looking like that. Out we went, but I got in there. First guy I was in there with was Divers, which again, can't say enough good stuff about Icky Divers. Anyway, did a few little bits and pieces. Wasn't great. It was a little bit clunky on my part, but it was what it was. I was in the Zach Dynamite. Was in there as well. Huge love for Zach Dynamite. He came in with a few shots, boom, in with a forearm, in with a boot. At one point, he clocked me with a boot, and it's nice because you can see in the footage, hits me with it. I crumple in the corner, you know, like a bit of paper. And he comes right down on top of me, which looks like he's just diving in. He actually just dove in and went, "Are you okay?" and it was good, did a little thing, Divers eliminated me, and I went through the back, and I, born again, the bug was back. I was well and truly like, I want more of this, so continued on with the training, and I had a few months in between where I was doing a few talking segments, which was fun because I've always enjoyed talking. It was essentially like commentary, but for 10 minutes and in the ring. And it was setting up, it was doing, getting involved in a nice little thing with Mark Hunter and Glory Hunting Agencies. Mark Hunter, brilliant manager. I thought he kind of understood the role of being at ringside as a heel. Manager. He understood the role. He wasn't constantly trying to keep the attention on him. He understood that the important thing was what was going on in the ring, and at times he would interject himself where he was needed to keep the crowd going or to cause that little distraction. He was really good. So I really enjoyed that I was going to be working on a program with him and Omar and Sebastian Asher. I'm doing that thing where it's like,
those are the real names. Those are the real names. Yeah.
Not real names, because you go real names, folks go who? Or you'll say the real name and they'll think it's a different person because of the name. And no, you didn't, did you? So, Sebastian Asher. So that ran for a few months, and then in February 2023, I had my first singles match that I'd had in don't know how long, which went, for me, really well. I didn't come out of it going, well, that was terrible. The crowd reacted to it. I'd had a few months of being in front of the FCW fans, which are a pretty loyal fan base. They've all travelled. This was in Tapeworth that I was wrestling Sebastian Asher. By that time, I'd been doing my little Bret Hart gimmick. Everything about me is a gimmick. And if it's a gimmick I can steal from the 80s and the 90s, even better. I don't come up with anything myself. So I would go out, I'd have the little sunglasses, and I'd go out, blah, 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 and then I'd go out and I'd find a fan, and I'd go, oh, there you go, pop the sunglasses on, and get, oh, like, isn't that Randy a lovely guy? Yeah, I just gave away something for free. But that was catching on. So I got a good reaction from the crowd. There was a good bit of chemistry between me and Sebastian. A funny little side note, Sebastian told me, was it before the match or after the match, that he remembered watching me wrestle in the Adler complex, or Adler Centre, I can't remember what it's called, in Adler, when he was a wee boy. And it's like, he meant it in a nice way, but it's like, thanks, I feel old shit.
Oh, I mean, I can like one up that a little bit. When I came up for Ardler Mania, which we'll talk about, and Ardler in general, is after the show I was catching folk and speaking to folk, and I spoke to Spike Tierney, and he went, I remember when you did a couple of things in the Ardler complex, and I was like, no, that was like 10 years ago. Let's not revisit this. Let's just make me feel I'm tired. I traveled down. I had an absolute dick of a day with the trains. Don't make me feel even older when you just go, oh, I was a wee guy when I remember seeing you do that in-ring thing in Ardler. No, don't need this today. I'm going to go home and have a cry. But yeah.
There were quite a few kids that I remember from the shows at the Ardler complex. They were little shits. So I don't know if that was Sebastian and Spike were in amongst the little shit mob. It might have been. But yeah, Spike's another one that is he'd said the first live wrestling show that he went to. I don't think it was in Ardler. I feel it was somewhere else around about Dundee. I was in the main event, so it must have been bad. And yeah, it's like that's great. It's good to feel old. But I don't feel old. I don't want it to be like, oh, woe is me, oh, I'm such an old man. I feel better physically than I've felt in a long time. I mentally, it's weird. I thought, because I did the Rumble thing, and I then had the match with Sebastian. I think it built up to then Ardler Mania, the one that you would have been at, would have been me and Ryan Rudd teaming up to take on Hunter.
I think it was Nay Mercy, I think it was, wasn't it?
Oh, wait, would it been, was it the last one? Because that was like the big eight-man tag thing?
The eight-man tag was my first visit to Ardler for 10 years. So that was, but yeah, it was Nay Mercy was the tag team match.
Yes, that's right. So it was. Nay Mercy was the tag team match. And thank you for keeping me right. I have no idea what it is. And that was, so there was, I was having fun. The matches I was having were, they were working for me. Because I was never going to be able to do, for one, fast paced, because my cardio is the absolute drizzling shit. I try to get it up there, you know. I go on the treadmill, I go on a little bike thing, which is very different from getting in the ring and running the ropes gas so quickly. But because I do a lot of, I'll do Mr. Perfect stuff, I'll do Bret Hart stuff, I'll do Hulk Hogan stuff, Randy Savage stuff, I'll do all this stuff that you go back to like the late 80s, early 90s, watch and go like that. It, I still get blown up, but I can kind of keep it going, and it works for me. So I don't feel like an old broken down wreck. If I was to try and do a more modern style match, try and have a more modern style match, nobody would like that. I wouldn't like it. Whatever poor soul I was in there with would have the worst match of their career. The fans would wonder what they've just watched and would be looking for the money back. Because I go out there and I do the whole retro thing, which just was an accident. It was simply, I didn't want to be ravishing Randy Valentine. I thought, because of the age and because of what I like and blah, 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 I was like, I'll do a retro gimmick. Not thinking just how deep into that it would go and how much that would help me to keep going and just help me get over, which in the with the FCW fans. So yeah, it's been a brilliant time. It's been a great time. I've been having great fun. And I think one of the reasons is it's a great the group of folk involved in FCW are a great crew. You know, they're all pulling in the same direction. They're all pulling for one another, and they're all working as best as they can, putting maximum effort into every show that they're doing. For them, every show that they're on, every show that they're having, isn't just another show, which I know from Discovery and from being on that side of things, that you'll have, and this, I don't mean this in a negative way, and this is something that I'll circle back around to again later. But it is just another show. It is just another booking, because they've got a weekend of bookings or a week of bookings. You know, they've just come off of a show in front of however many thousands, or they've just come off of a dark match for something somewhere, or they've just come back from another country. So it is just another show sometimes. When it is, when you're in there, not say the matches are fantastic, the effort that the wrestlers will put in is still there, but I don't know. There's something extra, and I'm not saying FCW, but every place has got a WrestleZone. The crew in WrestleZone have got it. Every wrestling promotion that has a core roster isn't just a collection of folk from around about. I've got that same kind of passion.
I think for FCW especially, a lot of their core roster and their roster in general are kind of like a little bit like the Misfits from other promotions, other schools that they came from, and they got burnt out, they got burned by other places, and now they've congregated into one place, being at FCW. So not only are they trying to make FCW work, but they've got that chip on their shoulder going, well, you didn't see something in me, or you treated me badly, I'm going to show you you shouldn't have done that by just working my arse off for FCW and making this the biggest promotion I could possibly make it.
Yeah, that's it. That's exactly it. And the proof is there, because if you come along to any FCW show, but particularly those ones in Tulloch, the passion that the crowd show, and I mean, this is what has most likely started as a crowd of, and it definitely is, because the Tulloch is a licensed premises, there's a few folk. The dads have had a few beers, and I don't doubt that to start with, they'd filter through from the bar. They'd come through just to see what this wrestling thing's all about. And now, well and truly hooked in by the shows that are getting put on, the entertainment that they're seeing. And that feeds back that the crowd are always really into what they're seeing. They're really into what they're, you know, the show that's getting put on. And other people coming in can feel that. Because, like I say, you've got that sort of core roster, but then you've got other folk that are coming in. You've got the foundation of the future. You've got Caleb Valhall, you've got Taylor Bryden, you've got ADM has been Hunter Sampson, the Meat Factory, Andy Roberts, you know, all these guys that have been have come in for a wee hot shot every once in a while. And they feel, they come back, they hear the crowd, they feel the reaction that they're getting from the crowd. And it's a great atmosphere to be in. And yeah, it absolutely is. I think there's a few guys there that feel like, not maybe necessarily that they've got something to prove, but because of maybe where they have been before, that's been a bit of a detriment to them. And now they want to show that, yeah, they might not have had the best of associations in the past, but what they've got now is great. You know, I don't even know what it is. It's not politics or anything like that. It's not that, but it's a great, like, camaraderie. Does that?
They're all working for a common goal, kind of thing. They're all working for the company, not working for themselves necessarily.
They're not worried about getting the rug pulled out from under them. They're not worried about whether or not whether or not they've got to go and hunt John down so that they'll get the petrol money to get home or any of these kind of things. They're there. They're having a good time. They work on their looks. They work on their gimmicks. They work on their crowd. All of these things, and each time get better and better and better because they're feeding off of that crowd base that fan base that they've got in the crowd. And it's certainly that's been a huge thing for me is that reaction from the crowd and the interaction. I mean, a lot of things are kind of different now because, well, yeah, there was Facebook and there was social media and stuff like that. It wasn't, I don't think, quite where it is now to where it was 12 years ago, say. And so even little things like that, having a slightly better understanding of social media, YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, the way to interact with fans and the fans can interact with you. The meet and greet sessions that they have at the shows are great to get the crowd coming in. And every show, you know, got the little, there's a kid with these, oh, there's a kid with these, oh, there's a kid with some of these, well, oh, there's some of these, little retro bear, yeah, oh, there's a kid with a little retro bear. The stuff that's I've got in the gimmick table, which is kind of now part of my gimmick, shows that even though it is £2, £5 for the glasses, they put their hand in their pocket and went, I'm going to give this guy a fiver because I really like what he's doing. Or the glasses look kind of quirky and they bought them because they looked kind of quirky and then I came out wearing them and they went, oh, that's the guy that's wearing the glasses that I bought. I'm going to cheer for him. So I don't know which came first, but it has helped build the momentum that I've got in FCW. And the crowd reaction that I'm getting. And off the back of that, I feel my match quality is getting a bit better. The matches I'm putting on, I wasn't terrible, but I'm not having match of the night. You know, it's not even on the bucket list that I would like to one day win the match of the month poll in the SWN Awards, because it's not going to happen unless there's some kind of disaster where every other wrestler in Scotland is incapacitated. But I'm happy with my matches. The fans are happy with my matches. The folk I'm in there with are happy with the matches. That to me is win, you know? That to me is, well, I'm happy.
I mean, yeah, do you think, not just because you feel like you're, do you think it's all mostly mental health based? Because in the place where you were before, it was a bit more, there was so much just shit going on from what I hear and from what I've seen myself. That was always kind of, there was always this kind of dark cloud whenever you went to actually go out and wrestle. There was always like, I'm going to wrestle this for, do this for 10 minutes, and I'm going to go and chase whoever to get that, get my payment or whatever. So that's all, there was always like a catch you having a match, whereas now you're going in, you know, the roster is chill, and I say that as a at this point when this goes out as a 34-year-old man, chill, that everyone's kind of working towards that goal. So it takes that, there's no dark cloud when you go out there. You're just allowed to enjoy yourself and allowed to actually be Retro Randy for 10 minutes.
I'd start having a, being in a much better environment definitely has a big impact on things. And mental health, an interesting thing to bring up, because there are wrestling, I think it attracts a certain kind of person. Before you've got any thoughts of getting into wrestling or anything, like, I think it would be the same with in a different direction. It'd be the same with acting, so you would get enjoyment out of pretending to be somebody else in front of a bunch of other people. People will sit and watch you pretend to be somebody else, and if you do a convincing job of pretending to be somebody else, the people who have watched it will go, "Well, that was a very good job. Thank you very much. I enjoyed that." Boxing or any kind of martial arts, things like that, you want to get involved in a pastime that is going to hurt and you're going to get hit in the face. It attracts a certain, I think, mentality. With wrestling, especially over in the last few years, thankfully, it's become more recognisable that there are mental health issues within wrestling. There are people involved in wrestling, and as wrestling has become more, I'll say, accessible. Don't know if that's the word that I want to go with. I would say it's become a lot safer. I feel comfortable saying it's not safe, unfortunately. Like everything, there's nowhere that doesn't have a bad element. Mm-hmm. Wrestling will always, unfortunately, have a bad element. Even more difficult when wrestling isn't necessarily governed the way of a lot of other things are. And so some things, unfortunately, fly under the radar, don't get noticed, or they do get noticed and they don't get mentioned. The whole gets noticed, doesn't get spoken about because of fear of losing a booking. That is a lot less. It's not gone, but it's a lot less than it was, which means it is a safer environment for people to get involved in and to thrive in, to do really well in, to feel comfortable in. But that doesn't mean that people won't still have the same mental health problems, same struggles that they have in, we'll say, real life, they'll have in the fantasy life of wrestling. You're going out there, you are relying a lot on the opinion of other people. You're putting a lot of faith and a lot of importance on the reaction of other people to you. If you're a heel, if you're a bad guy and you can handle being a bad guy, you've got to know that you're going to go out there and you're going to get insults thrown at you. You're going to get horrible. You're going to get kids coming up, kicking at you and all the rest of it. And you need to be able to take that on the chin. You need to be able to shoulder that. If you can't, you need to at least feel that you can speak to somebody about it. Because it's not a nonsense to say, you know what, I feel really terrible. I did really well out there, but the heat that I was getting, it was kind of getting to me. It was getting on top of me. Things like that can be spoken about now. Feeling going out and feeling less about yourself, feeling a very, very wise, beardy man said, comparison is the thief of joy. And you will find that a lot of people go out there and they will compare to someone else. So maybe the match before got a louder reaction and they go out, don't get that reaction. They think, well, I didn't do a good job. I didn't do so well. Maybe I'm not good at this. And all those intrusive thoughts, I think, is what they get called. They all start eating in. But people speak about it now more. People are supportive of it now. Whereas before, that would have been something that would have been used against someone. If someone was like, the crowd weren't taking me there, I think you would have people go, you know what? I'm worried that you're going to take my spot. So I'll feed into that and I'll go, maybe you're not that great. Maybe you do. And, rather than try and help and support, it would be used in a much more negative way. Those kind of things are again, not gone, but greatly reduced. And so most locker rooms, just about every locker room, the ones that I hear of, the ones that I know of, I've got that supportive thing in the back to help with any kind of those mental health issues that people have. So it's fantastic to see that wrestling is a more supportive environment, much more aware environment of what's going on. And yeah, that's, I don't know, how did we get on this topic?
I don't know, to be honest. I asked a bit of a serious question, and we went down a bit of a darker path than possibly intended. But so we'll bring that back up slightly.
But it isn't, because even though it sounds it's a more serious topic and all the rest of it, it's not a dark thing. It is a positive. This is absolutely 100% a positive thing about how supportive the wrestling community is. It's taken a lot of hits. It's taken a few big losses over the past few years that stung a lot, and these things still happen, these losses still happen, but yeah, it's wonderful to see just how supportive wrestlers are with one another, which you know, that wasn't there 15 years ago.
So I'll dive back a little bit and talk about the Ardor Complex, because by my reckoning then, by the time you got back to the Ardor, it would have been a good 7-8 years, something like that, maybe. Possibly, for Nae Mercy. Did you get that kind of wave of
10? I would say it was probably 10 years. Yeah.
2014. It was 2014 or something. You had your last.
Was it?
Match. I think so. I'm trying to remember how many of those shows I went to.
Right. Yes, it is. Yes. 2014. So yeah, 8 years. 8 years.
So did you get that kind of wave of, oh my god, how I'm now back here again? When you were at the Ardler, because I know I felt that, and I never wrestled in it. I just know that I used to go down there quite regularly. There was 10 years later, and seeing the place going, Jesus, I've just got a wave of nostalgia, and I mean, some happy times, not so happy times, but still that kind of wave of that kind of flashback of going, God, here we are again, Dundee.
I wish I could say that I did, but no, I didn't. I thought I might, but no, it was just, you know, getting changed up in the bleacher seat bits up behind the curtain. It was familiar. I didn't really get a nostalgia thing, strangely enough. I think partly would have been because it was a great crowd, because that's the first one was Nae Mercy. It was a great crowd. It was packed out, which was, it was great to see. I was in a match that had story and had a good place on there. There was people looking forward to seeing it. My wife comes along and she's seen just about every match. My sister-in-law, her partner, uncle, people would come through to Perth. This was the first time that my mum and dad, my auntie and uncle, trying to think if there was anybody else there, that had seen me wrestle. My mum and dad, this was the first time they'd seen me wrestle since I kind of not long started out, a good maybe 20 years since they'd seen me wrestle. And that was in the village hall in a committee in front of, I think, you won't know, a committee. I was in a committee, like people would know what it is. Tiny little village just outside of Arbroath, which itself is a town outside of Dundee, so it's tiny, tiny. You think of Russian Dolls? Committee is the village equivalent of the last doll that comes out. So I think there was maybe about six folk there. So they were not impressed with the wrestling thing. So it was nice that they were there and they saw me on a much better presented show, and kind of got what the fuss was all about. So those things were really good. And no, I was about to say, and as a side note, did really well for merch that night. But no, I think I did okay. Adler Mania, mind blown. But yeah, there was a lot of other things. Being back in Adler, it was like, oh yeah, I remember this place. But I didn't get that nostalgia kick, strangely. But I still enjoyed it.
Speaking of Adler Mania, so that was the one I went to. That was the first and at the moment only FCW show, just because of traveling. I hate traveling. I've realized since I've had a child, if I can get home to my own bed the same night after a show, I am ecstatic. And that has made me feel so much older than I think I should be at this day and age. But so I went down there and I had that wave of feeling for the Adler Complex. Because to be honest, the Adler Complex, without that venue, I don't think I would be doing what I'm doing now, because that's what kind of kicked off. Well, that, and of course, Perth, the Jewish Centre, when you did the old jump off the steel cage. But without the Adler Complex going down there regularly, I don't think I'd be doing this podcast, doing all this kind of stuff. So possibly that's why I've got a little bit more of a oh God, here it is again. But you talked about you're kind of you didn't want to have the dads come and watch and go, oh, the wrestling shite. This is rubbish. But I remember when I was sitting there and there was like a dad like in front of me, and you came out for the 8-man tag, and he went, oh, I love this retro Randy Savage guy. He's amazing. He's great. And I was like, yeah, job done then. You've got the dads. That's a good draw to get, because dads generally take their kids to the wrestling. That's I don't want to be sexist about it, but generally it's going to be the dads that are doing it. So if you get them on board, then you've got them back. Because I know from my own experience, I went to a tribute show in 2001 with my dad.
Wow.
And he, after the show, I was 10 or 11, and he went to me and went, that wrestling's shite, I'm going to take you to that again. So it does work out that way. So Adler Mania then, huge merch haul. This is what, a year? Just under a year of your journey back mm-hmm. into the world of wrestling. So do you feel at that point that was when everything kind of, not peaked, peak's not the word, but is that when you felt like you had the full power of Retromania in that moment?
The wheels were on the road, you know. This was an 18-wheeler truck, and I would say about 15 of the wheels were gripping tarmac right there. Yeah, it was, it felt, in the zone, felt good. There are still things that I'm working on. You know, I'm going along more regularly to Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling training in Arbroath, which is FCW's training school feeder thing. Just to keep getting those reps. Like I say, there's a big difference between training in the gym, which I'm also sticking at a little bit better than I used to do, because it helps. But yeah, keeping in sort of ring fitness, which I'm not ring fit. Thankfully, the gimmick covers a lot of that. When I first started wrestling again, I thought, yeah, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna build up to the point that I'm gonna have a match that people will go, oh, I didn't imagine Randy could ever have a match like that. I'm not that fussed about that anymore, because I like what I'm doing. I'm happy what I'm doing. I keep working on the fitness and things like that. Keep working in the ring, keep trying to tighten things up, make things smoother. But for the most part, yeah, I'm happy. And yeah, it's always good. That's, I think, even back before, even, you know, when I was wrestling as Travish and Randy, I liked setting myself that little challenge, because I know people don't, wrestling's not a competitive sport. You know, because you're not competing with the person in the ring. If you did, although there is a little bit of not one-upsmanship, But, you know, you strive to be better. So you're both striving to be better. You're both wanting to look as good as you can look. So there's a little bit of competition, but not actual competitive competition. The competition is between the wrestlers in the ring and the fans. And the fight is getting the fans to react the way you want them to react. The dad that hasn't taken his coat off yet or is sitting there checking the results on the phone, yeah, he's sitting across that. See if you get them. I'll say chuckle because that tends to be the reaction that I'll get. But if you can get them to react, if you can get them to just go, all right, okay, I like that. Or even if you go out, if you're like a Caleb Valhalla, or if you're a Hunter Samson, and you go out there and you look like a wrestler, as in, you know, the wrestler on the telly is always going to be big, tall muscles. If you go out like that and you get their attention just to go, all right, he looks like a wrestler. He looks like he could be off the telly. Then you've got them. If you do something in a match that makes them react, even just for a few seconds, and then they go back to checking the results on the phone, you've got them. If it gets to the end of the show and they come away going, I'll take them back to that, then that is job done, because that means you have put bums on seats, and that's our role as wrestlers. As much as it's put on good match, you know, it ultimately, you want people to pay to come and see you. Because if people don't pay to come and see you, then there isn't a show. There isn't a promotion. And that filters through in just about everything. Amateur dramatics will eventually put on a show that they want people to buy a ticket to come along to see. Even school shows. School shows charge a little something to come along. You have to buy a ticket for a school show. You know, those are school children. They're not professional actors. But they still want to put on a show that then next year, they won't have folk going, I'm not going back to that thing. I went to it last year and it was an absolute disaster. I'm not going back. So, yeah, I love to try and get the dad, like we'll say, well, stereotypically, we'll go the dad. Not always the dad. Sometimes you've got groups of friends. You've got people who go along to the wrestling. There's maybe one or two are like, well, I'll come along to it because everybody else is going. Is there a bar? Well, all right, as long as I can have a drink kind of thing. They're not that bust for the wrestler. They come along, they see, you know, they see me going out doing the shit that I do and going, all right, yeah, that's pretty funny. I like that. That's fine. I'll take that. I'll take that as it went all day long.
Not to throw my dad under the bus again, but a guy that did that for him was Yunji Maki. He would only go to the shows. He'd always ask if, oh, is the wee clown fella going to be on it? And Yuji Maki, yeah. Oh, I'll take the grandkids along. That's fine. We'll come along and see that. So yeah. So as Ewan has pointed out numerous times, he is my dad's favorite wrestler. is my dad's favorite wrestler. That's that exact reason why, because he was the one guy that got him to unfold the arms and go, that's good wrestling. Before we get into the questions, I know you wanted to try and keep this as a tightish hour, which is not going to happen. I'll tell you that now. But the questions is the bit where people will be wanting to hear their name being said and being answered. So kind of that keeps some people on for a little bit longer. We'll speak about your tag team with Ryan Rude, Filthy Ryan Rude, as the current FCW tag team champions. Which will still be the case when this episode goes out, because there won't be a show until probably in about an hour's time once this episode goes out itself. So still current reigning, defending, and should possibly be tomorrow. So the team itself, Retro Filth, did you strike up? You had that match with Ryan first night in the Mercy, and then you had the tag team match the second night. What was it like getting in the getting in with Ryan, and did it kind of click straight away?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it did. It was the brainchild of Kevin Williams. He wanted to put us together as a team. I don't know why. I think it was just because it worked. In the context that we were going to get involved with Glory Hunter Agency. So we're going to get involved with Omar, Sebastian Asher, and Mark Hunter. And Ryan had a match previously with Sebastian Asher. So he had a little bit of history there. I had the better. And he thought we both enjoy the lighter, more lighter-hearted style of wrestling match. So he thought the two of us together would work. And I think it does. I think it works. I think it works really well. Thoroughly enjoying a little tag run. Again, it's good because I don't have to carry a whole match myself. Although I'm still a bit greedy and will always be the guy that wants to be in there and take the heat. You know? Because I just have to lie there and look like I'm getting battered and I'm exhausted, which I'm lying there exhausted and getting battered, so it works out well. But yeah, we've worked. Yeah, have a lot of fun with Ryan. There's some good banter there. There's a good little connection there. It's something that I would like to think can always just keep feeding back to. I don't know how long the run will last with the titles. I think once that's done, I don't know what the plan is. There's still a few things on my little checklist that I would like to check off, and the time that I've got to do that, I don't know. But I haven't given myself a time on it. I'm going to wrestle until I'm X age, and then all the day. I'll wrestle until folk stop cheering, you know, and I'll wrestle until folk get fed up with it. Or I'm like, if I get hurt, or yeah, the body goes. I'm not going to say like, I'm going to wrestle until it takes me too long to get back up, because it already takes me too long to get back up. I'm just doing it anyway. But it would be nice to think that there's always that little thing between me and Ryan that we can feed back to. You know, we can keep having a little tag match together. We can, if we cross paths and rumbles and things like that. I love threads in wrestling. Mm-hmm. I've got lots of them already out there. That I go, this is a little thing that we can keep calling back to. And that's why this thing is that a little bit more important. I think if you can put a little bit of history behind something, then you can go, like with Ryan and Sebastian Asher, the match they had, I think Ryan had a set of knuckle dusters that had Filthy on them that got stolen from him and used against him. And in the match I had with Sebastian Asher, tried to use them against me. Now, me and Ryan had no connection at this time, but Sebastian Asher still had the knuckles that he'd taken from Ryan Rude. And that's just a little thing. It's just a little garnish to what would eventually be the Retro Filth against Glory Hunter Agency's tag match. There's those little things on commentary. I loved threads. I loved little things that you could feed back to and bring in on commentary, the extra bits of story. So I love the relationship that me and Ryan have got. I love what we've done together as a tag team and continue to do as a tag team. We're doing a whole, it's just an open challenge thing. Rather than, you know, set opponents and things like that, just we will take what comes. So, at the Tullock on the 19th, I don't know who will be wrestling at the Queen's Hotel on the 20th. If we've still got the tag team titles, we will be defending them. Don't know who we're going to be defending them against. And so it will go. So it's nice. It keeps things a little bit. It's a little bit of mystery, I'm enjoying the run. I'm enjoying working with Ryan. He's good fun. We had just the weekend past there. We faced the Redgate combination of Samuel, because his name is in capital. So I feel like, so do you have to shout it? I think that must be Samuel. Like he's in trouble, and Valak. And then the next day at the Errol Gala, which was fun, we faced Tommy Cross and Samuel. So we had Redgate of two types back to back the Arrow, the Gala one was great fun because we just went off on a. And again, being a, like teaming with Ryan, it's good because we've got similar kind of thoughts and mindsets. So, like, you know what, we're gonna take it and we're gonna go have a little wander around. We'll go and fight around the crowd and see what they make of it. Some people did not know what was going on when suddenly there was these guys in spandex throwing one another around right next to them. But there was a what do you call them now? Is it, are they still death slides? The battle wire.
I always remember them as death slides. So yeah.
I don't know if that's, I've never heard of them. They've changed the name. They're certainly not an official. So there's a death slide. It's like, so got separated, and then it gets to the point I'm looking around. I'm like, I don't know where they've gone. And as I'm going around, I'm asking folk, have you seen the wrestler? Have you seen wrestlers come this way? Yeah, they went that way. I'm just getting to the death slide as Ryan's wheeling the thing up. Samuel's down there. So I dives over, grabs Samuel, gets him. He chuckled. I goes, you're not going anywhere. And then Ryan comes sliding down, boots first, boom, and up. It's just good fun. Funny thing, Samuel didn't know it was me, and for a moment thought a punter had just grabbed him. I'd got a little bit too involved in the wrestling. I'd maybe had one too many shandies, and I'd been, you're not going anywhere. It's like, it's okay, it's just me. But yeah, had great fun, and the fact that Ryan all the way up and was doing the gala the next day, it was great fun. Galas are fun. Believe it or not, until last year, I'd never worked a gala. I did the hall when I first started out. I did the holiday camps all down around about Yarmouth and Hemsbane places, but I'd never done an actual gala show. And so yeah, popped my gala cherry last year, and I love them. They are just, because you don't know who's there. It's not wrestling fans that's there. It's just a bunch of folk. You're outside, you're wrestling, hopefully in the sun. Yeah, brilliant. And again, great that Ryan had the same mindset. Just, it was a great weekend, and I'm looking forward to the next weekend as well. I've been loving the whole tag run with him just now. It's been brilliant, really good.
When you're talking about the lore and stuff like that, I remember when you came up to Rap the Anarchy at Dainston, and that was the first time I'd seen you in probably about 10 years as well. And you and Quacky were chatting away, and every so often one of you would chip in and ask me for a bit of the information on why is this match happening, or why is this a thing, or did this happen here, and all that kind of stuff. And to be honest, I got to stretch my WrestleZone knowledge, which I... Give me a question. I will bore you for 5 minutes with an answer. But yeah, I was just like, you wanted to know the ins and outs and the hows and whys we got to this point, and it just showed how much you were just in the moment and just enjoying it and wanting to know everything about it at the same time. So yeah, I enjoyed it. I tried seeing you because, like I say, it's been years at that point outside of a Zoom call. Yeah. So it was a good time. Let's get into the questions then, because we have many. We have so many.
Really? I thought there was only going to be like one.
Oh no, and they're everywhere. So I've got tabs.
Have you just in yourself and just put like false names? Or...
Oh no, no. I mean, I've got four tabs open of places where I've got questions. So I'm going to try and figure them out. We'll start with my DMs on Twitter/X. Always a dodgy place to be a part of, but we've got the Asian sensation Omar Muhammad. With less of a question, just more of a statement. So it's quite the statement to read. Tell Randy that I'm proud of him for finally hitting a move off the top rope without falling off the first time. Also tell him that I'd given him the biggest payday of his career if he chose to wrestle me, but decided to have his return match. Okay, he's fucked up his grammar here. But decided to have his return match with Sebastian Asher for whatever reason. Also add that he could have afforded a better video editing software and cool robes like mine.
I'm going to recycle a little joke I'd already given Omar. I am quite happy with the editing software I've got. It has got a whole bunch of useless gimmicks that I've no interest in. I call them my Omars. Yeah, Was there a question? There wasn't a question.
No, there wasn't a question. No, it was just more of a statement.
Then we dig about me falling off the top rope, which I have for. I think there was a couple of votes went in the 2023 awards for Feud of the Year was me and the top rope, and the top rope was winning. Top rope kicked my ass in 2023. Fell off that top rope way too many times. Haven't fallen off of it this year.
That's 6 months. That's pretty good.
Halfway through the year, and I've been up the top quite a lot, and I haven't fallen off of it. I've hit some crack. I love my elbow drop. So I'm always disappointed when I fall off the top rope, because once I'm up there and I come off, great. It's just that initial, I don't know, getting my balance. My balance is terrible. But I haven't fallen off the top rope. I did fall on my ass from a big boot because I was way out of position. Totally fluffed it. But yeah, I haven't fallen off the top rope this year. So to you, Omar, our match would draw nothing. So I've got no interest in wrestling you, Omar, or your fancy robes. And my robe's fancier. So
I would throw in some shade about the video editing software, but I use Windows Movie Maker, which is possibly the oldest video editing software known to man. I had to go and find, on archive.com or something like that to reinstall it to my newer laptop, because it's like everything else you have to pay for, or it's got a wee watermark or stuff. But no, Movies Maker, trim it. Yeah. It does. I can fade in. That's all I need. That's pretty much all I need for.
I can't remember what it's called. Project. I can't remember. Doesn't matter. Also, just before we leave Omar behind, thankfully, while he's talking about it, he had a little promo came out last year. I think it was last summer that he did it as like a little movie trailer thing for Omar and had a voiceover. I was the voiceover man. I did his cool voiceover for that. So, yeah, nah. Throw as much shade as you like, Omar. I know I'm your hero, so yeah.
Back on Twitter, then we've got two through there. We've got the inspirational Ryan Riley, and I've got a feeling that he usually does a dear Mr. Strack, and he does all that kind of stuff. He's just put low bridge ?
Yeah, it's still happening as we speak. It's still going on, and I have yet to land on the floor. Yeah, I was fortunate enough. Still beat them for the tag. Still got the tag titles off of them. For kayfabe's sake, but yeah, I loved the match I had with Ryan and Dan Zach Dynamite. I have said, and I will say now, and I will always say, I want my last match to be against Dan, against Zach Dynamite. That's, and again, going back to the whole threads thing, we've still got that little unanswered question, that unsettled thing from, do you remember, was it back before, I think it was before the Disco Derby, the one that came down to him and Emerson. I did a little interview thing with him at the WrestleZone Academy, because I was going up and training up there as well, which another great place to train. And Dickie, getting under the learning tree of Dickie and Scotty is fantastic. Even if Scotty's taste in zombie movies is, it's good, but it's not quite there.
Yeah.
His number one is, but that's not a thing. But yeah, I went and did the little interview, and it was like, I want him to slap me. And it's like, so you know, don't be shy. And he wasn't shy. Yeah. I felt that slap the whole drive home. And since then, there's been other little bits and pieces, and we had a little tag match. But yeah, I want to have a couple of singles matches. And I've said to Dan, and I will, this will be the way, unless something unexpected happens, then I would like my last match to be in there with Zach Dynamite, because I've got so much love for him and Ryan and Brad. Those guys are just, yeah, fantastic. But yes, that low bridge, the slowest low bridge in wrestling history. I think Guinness are actually just checking the details, but it might be a world record. And yeah, for fun's sake, it's still going on. I'm almost past the apron. My feet will touch the floor roughly around about 2026. So yeah, it's going on.
You mentioned Scotty. That leads me perfectly onto one of the questions we got through on Facebook, which is from Scotty. He's got two questions, but we'll start with the one that kind of led me into the segue. When is Randy going to accept that Day is better than Dawn?
Never. No. Dawn of the Dead, 1978, is the quintessential zombie movie. And I will, that is a hill I will die on. I'm the dude sitting at the table with a little mug, you know. Dawn of the Dead, 1978. Greatest movie, zombie movie of all time. Change my mind. Nobody is going to change my mind. It is what it is. And it's something we'll always, I don't know. I think there's feuds in wrestling have happened over less. So, you know, I don't know.
So we've got the other part of that answer in the Scotty Swift, most recent Scotty Swift episode, so people can go back and check that. I think it's about 2 hours long, so it's somewhere in there. He also added, thoughts on the lowest leapfrog in history in that four-way for that place, and then spits.
I don't remember the leapfrog. But I know the match that he's talking about. I think I know the match that he's talking about, which was an elimination four-way. And have I got it the right way around? That Johnny... No, Scotty was eliminated. Then Johnny was eliminated. And then Johnny was meant to come back out and cost me the match. Johnny never reappeared. So the end of that match ended up being, rather than a sneaky... And I don't even like to think about the... The heel that was in the you can edit this bit out if you like.
Is it the pirate?
You know, there's the little meme, the little joke about if I had a quarter for every time this thing had happened in this place, I would have two quarters. I know it's not a lot, but it's still weird that it happened in the same place twice. I have wrestled two paedophiles in professional wrestling, and both have happened in the same place. So if I had a quarter for every time, I'd have two quarters. It's not a lot of money, but it's weird that it happened in the same place. And that's horrible. So yeah, you can cut that out if you like. But yeah, I think that's the only time me and Scotty have ever met in a wrestling ring. I don't remember the leapfrog. I wonder who was leaping. If it was me, then yeah, you better believe it was low, because the white man can't jump, and I can't get myself far off the mat. And I fall from the top rope, so...
Just for my... I was going to say allegedly, but I think one of them was convicted. So just in case, you can pick whichever one that was.
Get it, bend that whole bit. That was horrible.
Ah,
that was
no, crazy. No, I'm keeping it in. That's fine. That's fine. We're not monetized.
This bit, for anybody that's still listening after that, if you have not checked out the Granite City podcast with Spooky Scott and Boo Ill, you're missing out. Listen to Scott and Bill talk about fantastically bad horror movies is my guilty pleasure. I wish they had time to release them more regularly than they do to highlight whenever there's a new one dropping. And it's all those horror movies that I think the condition is that it can't be a bad horror movie, as in there's like that meta thing, especially now. People are aware they make like Sharknado and stuff like that. They know they're making a shitty movie and they're kind of rolling around in the shittiness. It's the movies that were never intended. It's like they were made as, we're going to make a good movie here. This could be up there with The Exorcist. And it's not. It's really bad. It's beyond the door bad. Check them out. Give them after you listen to them.
I enjoy it. I've no intention of ever watching any of the films, but I do enjoy listening to Scott and Boo Will chat about it and their equipment, their £1,000 equipment and studio, which always makes me laugh because I don't think I've paid £7 for my webcam. That's about it. Authority paper on Zoom every
sound
month.
Quality. You can hear the money in the sound quality of those first few episodes.
Absolutely.
Outstanding. But oh, it's brilliant. I love it. I absolutely love that podcast. So anybody listening to this, check it out. Give it a listen. Give it a like.
Yep. All that money on that Echo. Who am I to judge? I've listened to some past quality. In the current quality, it's not that great either. But back to Twitter. We've got Duke. Why is The Dark Knight Rises the best of the Nolan Batman trilogy?
Come on. Why is everybody... Oh,
I'll before you go ahead with it. My dad's my dad's getting a ton of mentions in this podcast, but he likes his Batman films. He's not fussed for like comics or any of that stuff. He just like watching a Batman film. He didn't like Dark Knight Rises for one reason and one reason only. Just even at night, most of it was during the day.
There are so many. That's a whole episode of its own. I don't want to get into it, but just everything about it, the whole thing is terrible. Tom Hardy's Bane with his weird Romany Gypsy voice that he does. Tom Hardy does the weirdest voices in movies. Every one of them is bad, but every one of them is entertaining. And Bane's is the same. Batman is terrible. He's been gone for 8 years, so why do people still give a shit? His back's broken, but he gets fixed by getting pulled up on a rope. Why are those people in that prison, in that pit, in the middle of the desert? What have they done? They seemed like nice people. Nobody bothered them or tried to steal his shoes once. He gets all the way... How did he make the big fiery... Like, the time he spent, so he was waiting... So Jim Gordon gets sentenced to death by walking across a frozen lake that might crack under his feet, but in the meantime, just sort of spray petroleum on a bridge so that he can have a big bat symbol going on. That's pretty extra, you know. God, well, everything. Just the way that they jobbed out Bane twice in another movie. I mean, Batman and Robin, forgivable because it's Batman and Robin, but this, and then the whole Robin thing at the end was... I was already dead, but that was just, you know, another bullet in the head just to be sure. I remember there was an interview with Christopher Nolan about Robin being in, but this was maybe around about the time of The Dark Knight. And Christopher Nolan said he would never put Robin in a movie because the whole premise of Robin was just ridiculous. And the fact that right at the end, they shoehorned in that horrible little... you should go by your real name, Robin, or whatever the hell it was that they said. That, to me, was Christopher Nolan saying, by the way, I have cashed the check. I did not want to make this. This was not fun for me. This was all about the money. I've taken the money. Enjoy the shit show that I have presented you with. Because it was just, from beginning to end, what was that thing he was flying around in? Like, I love the Nolan movies. They're grounded in realism. What was that spaceship that Batman flew around in? The bomb. The fact that they gave away the end of the movie halfway through the movie because Michael Caine wanted to have a little speech. He was speaking to Bruce Wayne in a cafe in Paris. It was the whole thing. Drizzling shits. It's just awful. Batman Begins is really good. The Dark Knight is really good. Dark Knight Rises. No, the Batman is a far superior Batman movie to The Dark Knight Rises, in my opinion. I mean, the Adam West Batman movie is a superior Batman movie to The Dark Knight Rises. It's just awful.
Dark Knight Rises is the only Batman film I've paid for to see in the cinema. Which, you know...
It's really unfortunate. That's really what you paid to see one of the worst ones.
I know, and I haven't seen The Batman. And at this point, Ian Skinner is so disappointed in that fact that I'm just now refusing to watch it. Just for my own enjoyment of disappointment that it causes him.
Keep working. That's good. Yeah. But no. What next?
Next up, we've got Daniel on Instagram. Does adding of Doom to the end of a move's name make it more powerful?
Yes.
Oh, that was easy. Does that mean profits of Doom make loads of money?
What was that?
Does that mean profits of Doom make loads of money?
Yes. I don't know. maybe, or maybe the profits are doomed. Maybe they make no money because the profits are doomed. I don't add of doom to the end of anything. I think I did it once or twice when I called for the elbow. But that was just stupid because it's not Hogan's move. It's Savage's move. So it's the Savage elbow. And it is Savage because I will land my whole fucking body on you. That's, it is the end of the match. Nobody's kicking out because I've just landed on you. It is a nice, big, beefy lat drop. But the leg drop of doom, it's always been the leg drop of doom. It was when Hogan had it. It was, you know, it's always been known as the leg drop of doom. The only reason I call it the leg drop of doom is to differentiate it. It's not just a leg drop. It's Hogan's leg drop of doom, which may or may not be followed up by the thermos of doom. You know, if you've listened to Tony Schiavone, I don't think. But if there's ever a match, if I have a match between myself and Patrick Peterski, or if Retro Filth and the Not Suitable for Mums have a tag match, you better be ready because I will be calling every move in that match. It will be a punch of doom. It will be a kick of doom. It will be a back rake of doom. Everything. Just for him, I will add of doom. But I don't add of doom the end of everything, but I should, because it does make a move more. The finger poke of doom. Has there ever been a more dangerous finger poke?
That's it. Undefeated. With that move. I like the, not that I like this, because I don't want to feel it myself, but the full weight elbow drop thing, I just remember, and this may be a surprising comparison when I say this. I remember there was an interview with Jeff Hardy that was saying that he stopped like pulling back his landing for the Swanton. He now just goes, he'll just pancake you because he's too old and he can't be bothered now. So if you take the Swanton, you're getting the whole weight of Jeff Hardy going forward, because he's not arsed for like hurting himself any more than he has to do it. Yeah. So
if I'm in there with somebody that I know will be comfortable with what it is, then it is what it is. I still take some, like I don't just splat on a guy. There's a fantastic photo from, I'm not going to remember his Instagram handle, unfortunately, but he's at the FCW shows. He takes really good photos. He does a whole gimmick. He does a little heel thing because he's a big fan of Jesse Ventura and Bobby Heenan. I find it entertaining. It's a gimmick photographer. Why not? He doesn't get involved in the shows. He doesn't think he's part of the shows. He does it on his Instagram, and I find it entertaining. His photos, fantastic. The photo of me dropping the elbow on Valak looks like I am literally, like, Valak's lying there, and I am horizontally just, is that like that above him. But I'd actually, my foot had just kind of got to the mat, and down I came, because I didn't want to hit him with a full. But other folk that I've been in, it's Divers Data, I think Divers Data. Most folk I've been there with, Prophets of Doom, when they took it, Dan took a brilliant elbow, one of the best elbows I've hit, was in there because I knew he would be okay with taking the lat. I take some on my hip, but I don't want to take too much on my hip because I don't want to fuck my hip. So yeah, it is. Maybe I should just do a sleeper or something safe instead to finish my
matches. Oh, a nice Roddy Piper sleeper. Yeah, absolutely. It's Photo Finisher 316. I think I'm definitely going to shout him out.
Photo Finisher 316, thank you. I just know G. That's all I know. That's what comes up on Instagram when he sends a little message thing. But yes, Photo Finisher 316. Check his work out.
So we'll go back to Instagram on the old phone device. Is God's Gift to Insta asking, what does it take to become the king of selling merch?
I'm not giving anything away here. Why would I tell anybody that and risk my spot? No, the merch, going back to it, because it is part of the, it's become part of my gimmick, kind of, because merch is a part, like, merch is a big thing in wrestling, but I would recognize, like, there's some t-shirts I would recognize. Obviously, there's some wrestlers' t-shirts and things you would recognize, but I don't feel that it's the same kind of connection that it maybe was back in, like going to the retro thing, I remember the WWF magazine, and in the middle was the little WWF catalogue thing that had all, and it had wrestlers wearing the t-shirt. So it had the Warrior and the Ultimate Warrior t-shirt, and it had, I'm trying to think of another, like, did Rick Rude have a t-shirt? I don't think he did. Texas Tornado in a t-shirt, and it was like, these guys don't wear those things. The only place you ever saw them wearing these gimmicks was in this catalogue. But you were like, oh wow, there's the Warrior wearing a Warrior t-shirt. I want to have a Warrior t-shirt. Guys like Tito Santana and the Rockers would maybe come out wearing the merch. Hogan, obviously, was, you know, the yellow t-shirt, the sleeves and everything cut off, the Hulk rules on the front. That's what the first few times I was going out with my retro rules. I've got the little retro Filth bear, as you can see there. It's got the little, and another little thing I'll come back to. This is all me. I don't make the bears, but the little shade gimmicks that they're wearing, make them, make the t-shirt, make the little sleeve things. I love it. I enjoy making my merch. My merch fits my gimmick. I wear the little sleevey things out. I wear the sunglasses out. What else have I got? I've got, like, the t-shirt. I just happen to have my merchandise sitting right next to me. I'm wearing the ships, yeah. But, like, even that, so the logo, I drew the logo, I designed the logo, I drew the logo. I love it. I love that side of it. The t-shirts make me no money. The glasses make some money. I take in a decent amount of merch. What it cost me for that merch isn't as much, but it's not that far behind. I don't make a massive profit. I'm not doing it for a massive profit. I'm doing it because, for me, personally, when we're doing the meet and greet, or even just to go out for the match, and there's all these kids, and they're all sitting wearing shades, and there's some of them who've got the t-shirts on, and there's some of them who's holding a retro bear. I go, they've put their hand in their pocket, they've taken out their money, hard-earned money, or, you know, not a lot of people have got a lot of disposable income just now. Wrestling fans do. Look, you've got loads. Look at the belts and everything you've got behind you. But for the most part, you know, these kids. So it is. I get a thrill out of it. Wrestling is 100% my hobby. And I know a couple of folk out there will try and use hobby as a dirty word to try and insult people. But realistically, 95% of wrestlers in the country, it's not their job. It's not their profession. They would like it to be, but it's a hobby. And I would like to think that they're enjoying what they're doing, because you enjoy a hobby. You know, that's the whole point of a hobby. I don't wrestle for the money. I get money from it. I get paid for it because that's... You should, you know, everybody should get something out of it. You know, it covers petrol and things like that. It gets you a munch, gets a McDonald's on the way home. The gimmicks out on the table, get a little bit of extra money brought in. But again, it's all part of my enjoyment. It's all part of what I enjoy doing. Mm-hmm. If you're looking to make money on the merch table, for one, you need to find stuff like t-shirts. T-shirts aren't going to make you a lot of money, because to get professionally made t-shirts, unless you're buying them in thousands, are you selling thousands? No, you're not. So unless you can print them yourself, or you've got a pal that's willing to print them for you or something like that, it's going to cost you money. You're going to make a couple of quid on a t-shirt. You're not going to make a lot of money on it. Temu, AliExpress, all of these kind of places, have a look on them. Find something that doesn't cost a whole lot that you can sell for cheap, because you have to remember who you're selling these to. You have to remember they've already bought the ticket. They've probably bought themselves some juice and crisps and stuff like that. It's becoming an expensive night out. If it's an expensive night out, like the cinema, not a lot of people go to the cinema because the cinema's too expensive to go to. You don't want to put people off coming to the wrestling, so you want to have stuff that you can sell at a low price, that there's a good chance that, because ultimately what you want is you want folk to have your merch. You want to see people with your merch, enjoying your merch. If that means you take a little bit of a hit on the profit that you make, so be it. So these, I sell these at like £2. I think it cost me about 70. I can't remember. It's the thrill of seeing them. If anybody wants to be out there and they're looking to make money on merch, find something that fits your gimmick. Ideally, if you can wear it out to the ring so folk can see you wearing it, then they go, ah, great. But it is, it's just be creative. If it's something that you want to do, if it's going to become a ball ache and you become obsessed over, I've bought all this shit and I can't sell it, don't do it. Because don't do things that is going to make your wrestling experience in any way miserable for you. Because it has to be fun. Because we're not doing this for a living. Amazing. For the folk that are doing it as a living, fantastic. And congratulations. And it's amazing to see. And more people are. But it's still, in the grand scheme of things, a small percentage that are doing it as a career. For a lot of folk in wrestling, and this is safe to say, this is fair to say, because again, going back to comparisons with music or acting or anything like that, the number of people who make it professional compared to the number of people who do it for fun, huge discrepancy. So you have to accept the fact that you're going to be doing it for fun. You have to enjoy that you're doing it for fun. If you can find a way to sell merch that fits your gimmick, that will give you that thrill of seeing somebody with your merch on, go for it. Otherwise, don't stress about it. I happened to come across this purely by accident, and now it's kind of become part of my gimmick. I've also got a very impressive point of sale as well, which doesn't hurt. I don't just have the stuff sitting on the gimmick table. I've got a whole stand thing, which again, I'll send you a photo so you can flash the graphic up on the screen so people go, all right, that's what he's talking about. But yeah, that's the answer, God's gift to Insta's question.
So. Yeah, I mean, and for myself, I agree with everything. If you see a wrestler wearing an armband, then you're probably going to go buy the armband. You know, that's how it works. But things like 8x10s, you know, just a wee thing with a signature. If a kid sees the wrestler and they want to get a signed photo, that's money right there. And then I've got a whole folder here of signatures and that I've collected over the years, and it's just cool to look back on and go, oh, I remember when I met this person and all that kind of stuff. It's great. Last question that we've got here is for Patrick Potierski, which I think is a nice question to round off on, because you've talked about it at length, the journey, what you felt like when you left and what you felt like coming back. He's asked, comparing wrestling from before and after you returned, what's been the biggest change?
Okay. This been a lot. The whole thing, I think, has changed in most ways for the better. I mean, from my point of view, from my standpoint, I don't know. I can't speak for everyone, and I can't speak for different levels, shall we say, professional wrestling. But I think the accessibility of wrestling, the accountability in wrestling, and just the environment, it is a much safer environment now, which is good. Things are a lot more open. People are much more aware. People are much less, I don't want to say accepting, but accepting is maybe the only word that could be used. They're much less accepting of nefarious things going on in wrestling. Whereas before, people would turn a blind eye to things. And I'm not talking about the worst of the worst, but even little things, like I'm saying little things, it's not little things, but bullying. And there was a lot of stuff that would come under the guise of banter, which wasn't banter. It could verge on cruelty, which, you know, I've witnessed it. I would be lying if I say I haven't ever partaken in it. You know, when things are going on and, you know, the things ramp up and up, and it gets funnier and funnier, and more people join in. So it goes. Those things don't happen anymore, and that's good. That I can see, that I'm aware of, and I don't think they do, because it is a much more professional, wrestling is much more professional than it was. By professional, I mean that there are genuine opportunities now for people to make a living out of it, for it to be that they're sold it, for, you know, whichever way they want to go. You've got, I mean, obviously, you've got your top tier. You've got your guys that are over in WWE and are in NXT and in TNA. That's their job. That's what they do for a living. And to get there, they have sacrificed a lot. You know, there's nobody has got to where they are without sacrificing. You know, ask Jack Morris how many friends' birthdays he's missed, you know, Christmases, things like that. Ask Drew McIntyre, you know, how many things. Yeah, ask all these guys that are at top level. You know, wrestling has been it, and everything else has to take a back seat, even bringing it down a wee bit from there. And you have like Arnie Roberts, another good example. He makes a living from wrestling, not from being in the ring as a wrestler, but also as a coach and as a promoter, as an owner of two prestigious wrestling schools, an operator, you know. He can't be involved in the nonsense that used to go on. He can't be aware of the nonsense that used to go on, because he is in a position where he needs to be trusted, he needs to be able to protect, he needs to be accountable for the students that are under him, for people. So there are, and the more people that then shun these things and go, that you shouldn't be doing that, that's not right, the less it happens. Like I say, I'm not saying it doesn't still happen in little corners here and there, and there are too many wrestling promotions out there. I could end that sentence there. There are too many wrestling promotions out there, but there are too many wrestling promotions out there that don't work with anybody else, that don't know anybody else, that do their own thing in their little corner, and that's where the mold can grow. But for the most part, wrestling's a much safer environment. Much more accepting. It's wonderful to see the people that, and again, this is going back to the whole using hobby as an insult, is ridiculous. Tom Hardy doesn't make any money from any of those judo tournaments he takes part in. That's his hobby. Is anybody going to go up to Tom and go, Tom, you want to stop with the judo? You're hardly making any money, is it? It's just your hobby. Yes, it is, and I love it. Folk make model trains and don't make any money from it. It's their hobby. It costs them a fortune, but they love it. Wrestling starts off as something that you love. And now the fact that people who love wrestling, who 20 years ago, no way, 10 years ago, would have been brought in, fleeced by a training school for years and years, because at no point would they ever be told, you can't be a wrestler because we're not going to put you out in front of a crowd. Now, people are given the opportunity to flourish. People are given the opportunity to be who they are and incorporate those gimmicks into the wrestler that they want to be, and they're given the opportunity to do it at whatever level it is. They're given the opportunity to do it as long as it's safe, you know. Look at Power Pro, fantastic example, where there be wrestlers and the showcases they put on. Wee Alfie, mini meat machine, right? Now, if he'd went out there and was getting power bombed through a table, I think there would probably be complaints, because no. But the fact that he got to go out there, he got to team up, and he got to be out there in the ring, and he got to live, he's living the dream, that's fantastic. And that is something that you definitely couldn't have had that happen. Like 20 years ago, it wouldn't have happened because somebody would have done such stupid. 10 years ago, it wouldn't have been an environment that's like, shouldn't be in that. Now, I think that is a good example of how safe and well-run a lot of the arms of pro wrestling is, because it is a safe environment for people, not just vulnerable because of age, but vulnerable because of so many other things. that you can be part of wrestling. They're not going to be taken advantage of. They're not going to be hurt. They're not, you know, they're safe because the majority of people involved in wrestling are all looking out for the same thing. They want it to be a clean business. They don't want that going on. That, for me, that is the biggest change in wrestling. And it's fantastic to see. It's the best thing to see.
And he's also added at the end there, once they're done with Redgate, Retro Filth versus Not Safe for Mums needs to happen one day, which you've already kind of...
with all the Doom moves. Remove Doom. Followed by me, Pinfall of Doom on Paddy.
But no, you talk about hobbies and that, and you know, it's if you don't enjoy it, then why continue doing it and all that stuff? We just passed 4 years of, like, when we're recording this a week ago, I did my first podcast. It was with Omar, and here we are 4 years later, and I'm still doing it, and I'm still finding the energy to do it because I enjoy speaking to you. I enjoy speaking to wrestlers. I mean, we've met face to face. I'm not very talkative in real life, but at least this way, I can have a chat and we have a good time. And I think that keeps me connected to the wrestling world without having to actually do anything physical, which I have no interest in doing. So it's a nice way to do it. But yeah, it's great to hear that we heard it last time when you just kind of got back in, but it's good to hear that you're in a good place of wrestling. You're enjoying it. The fact that you're traveling to all these schools as well. You're not just like going, oh, I'm just going to do my little thing here at Fair City. No, you're traveling up to Aberdeen. You're traveling to Fife, to all these places and you're seeing the changes that are being made, where by all rights, after like the way you exited, you could have just sat and wallowed and thought everyone was still an absolute shitebag, and there's still shitebags out there, but it is great that you're experiencing a good side of wrestling after 20 years of giving it a go.
I'd said at the start, I love the fact that being back involved with wrestling, I'm a bit more driven with my physical health, my fitness, and things like that. It's a great outlet. I'm in a very stressful 9-to-5, and so it's nice to have that little bit of nonsense escape that wrestling provides. And that's it for me. I'm kind of like, I'm capped. I've got a few things that it would be nice if I could do these things at some point down the road. I'd still love to work for WrestleZone, because I've never wrestled for WrestleZone. Outside of that, I've got no interest in wrestling anywhere else, simply because it's a hobby. I love my hobby. If I was losing every weekend to it, might not love it as much. My wife most certainly would not love it as much. I know my limitations. I don't mean that as in I can only go as far as I can go. I'm not sitting here going, if I wanted to, I could be at WrestleMania. I don't think I could be at WrestleMania if I bought a ticket. But I could put in the graft, I could put in the grind, like a lot of people do, going out there, trying to get other bookings here and there, starting to spread out, but I genuinely don't have the time for that. I don't want to do that. I love working for FCW, I love being part of FCW. I love watching it continue to grow. I want to be the best version of myself I can be in FCW, so that, you know, it's another bit of that. I would like to, by the time I'm finished, I would like to look like a wrestler, which is weird, because I probably should have done that a long time before now. But I'm going to the gym more regularly, doing all the lifting heavy things and stuff like that. And that, for me, I'm like, that's good. That's it for me. I want to represent FCW. I want to do what I can there and enjoy what I'm doing. And I have no regrets. Again, going back to comparison is the thief of joy. I'm not looking at what other people are doing and going, see, because I'm not doing that, then what I'm doing isn't good. What I'm doing for me is fantastic. And for anybody else listening to this who are starting out on the wrestling journey, or they've been on it for a long time. There's a lot of folk out there that have been wrestling for a lot of years, and I'd maybe still like, I'm not really going anywhere. I'm not really getting anywhere. I think there needs to be a little bit of realism. I think people need to understand that not everybody is going to be at the top, because you can't. There is nothing wrong with being the best version of you in front of whatever that crowd is that comes along to see you regularly. Wherever you are based, wherever you wrestle most, you're going out there and you're getting a reaction from them. Let that pop be the thing that you go, that's great. Don't let anybody else, don't let any person out there tell you that what you're doing is worth less by trying to say that you just do it as a hobby, because the majority of us are all doing it. The majority of folk that are listening to this right now, because if they've got time to listen to a podcast, they're not busting their ass on the road 7 days a week. We're all doing it as a hobby, and we're doing it because we love it. And if you've looked past that and you don't care about the enjoyment anymore, you just want to know about how much money you can keep getting from people, how much money you can keep putting in your electric meter while you're burning your trainees, then that's, if that's the way you want to go, that's the way. If that's, it's shite, but do it. Yeah. Nobody's going to be able to talk you out of it, or nobody's going to be able to change your mind by now because you've been doing it for long enough. You're just getting going. You're just in there and you're like, oh, I wish I was further on. Either put the time in and understand you've got to sacrifice a lot, because all of those guys, like I said, that are up there have had to sacrifice a lot to get there. Or you go, you know what? If I could just be happy with doing what I'm doing, then I'm just going to be happy doing what I'm doing. Yeah, I'm happy doing what I'm doing. I love doing it. I'm the happiest I've ever been in wrestling, doing what I'm doing just now. I love it. I go out there on the tullock, I get a pop. If I fall off the top rope, which I haven't done this year, but even when I was falling off the top rope, people didn't go, oh my God, this is the biggest little shake. I got a chuckle out of it. I mean, oops, yeah, it's an age thing. Got back up there, came off again. Enjoy wrestling for what it is. Take what you want from it, and don't let somebody else determine what wrestling should be to you. Because it's all a hobby, and I love mine.
You definitely jinxed yourself. You're falling off the top rope tonight. You do, when this comes out, you do realize that.
I do it on purpose. We will see. We'll revisit in 18 months' time and see if the tally's gone up.
we're 45 minutes over our time that we thought we would be, which, you know, that's just Randy Valentine all over from what I hear, going over the allotted time. But as we finish off then, plug your socials. You've plugged your merch to no end, but where can people get it? Where can people message you to pre-order? Give me all your socials.
Well, I don't know. It's just Retro Randy. I think I'm Retro Randy on Facebook. I'm Retro Randy on Instagram. And I think I'm Retro Randy on YouTube. Those are the only three I've got.
Randy Facebook. Says relax _ on Twitter if you still use it.
I came away from Twitter. I don't really use Facebook that much. I like Instagram. I do, again, going into the hobby side of things, and when I'm saying about I like making my merch and stuff like that, do a lot of crafting stuff. I love scratch building. I love trash bashing, I think they call it. Little paint little figures and all that kind of custom figures and stuff. I did a little line years ago of custom wrestling figures for Discovery Wrestling, which was an absolute ball ache. And this was an example of, don't let, like, if you put the monetary value on your hobby, then your hobby's no longer fun. It was no longer fun for me. But I want to get back in. I want to make little Hasbro Retro Randys. And I'll make the basic one. I will cast it, and then I can cast them in resin, and they'll maybe have little bits of articulation. I don't know. But that's what I like to do. I will document doing it, because my YouTube just now, I did these little gimmicks in here. I gave it to it like that thing there. I think you put that up on
it's on the thumbnail. Yeah.
It's on the thumbnail. If you scan that, it will take you, as my wife said, oh, that's great, it will take folk to your 18 subscribers. Well, I've got 19 now. So check out my YouTube, because I would like
literally
to 19. Yeah, it went up by one. after the gala when some of these went out. This is a sticker, by the way, which I made myself. So yeah, I'm wanting to maybe stick some crafting stuff and things like that on there, because I enjoy, I like that community. I try to think of a way to marry the two together, and the first one that comes to mind is I love making my little custom Hasbros, and the Discovery guys that I'd done before. I think I can't remember all who there was. My favourite one was Tim Wiley, Deviation. It's a fantastic character. It's a shame that didn't get traction somewhere else. Shifted a lot of Joe Coffees, which I couldn't do now because I get a cease and desist from WWE. But yeah, I think I'll maybe make a little Hasbro Retro Randy that I can cast a few off and maybe stick on my gimmick table. If I'm doing that, I'm going to document what went into making that at each stage as it goes along. I'll be sticking that up on YouTube. The usual wrestling stuff goes up on there. I'll stick highlights of matches on there and stuff. So I always appreciate a few little views. Like and comment. You don't even need to subscribe. It'd be nice if you subscribed. If you don't subscribe, like and comment. Nobody ever comments. There's one guy comments on my videos. That's about it. Yeah, check me out on the socials. I still don't know how the hell I work it. I don't know what I need to do to get those numbers up. But
me neither. Me neither, to be honest. The audio is doing amazingly. I wish I knew what I did there because I don't know what's happening with the video. For my own request, because I'm now on a quest to try and get as many as I can, throw out a couple of trading cards, you know, get a rookie Ravishing Randy Valentine card out, get a retro Randy Valentine card out. That's the thing I really, I'm really, because it's very, I can put them in a box. I don't have to like see this wall of crap. But yeah, I'm loving seeing wrestling trading cards. It's coming back into fashion, and I'm loving it myself personally.
Oh, retro Randy Funko Pop. Funko Pops are easy because they don't have any articulation. They're just a massive head and a tiny body. You've not one of them. Yeah, send me the dimensions, what a trading card's meant to be, and yeah, I'm sure I could rattle something off.
Anyway, I'll get you a little card. We did the social wrap up, and we spent our 10 minutes. So we'll wrap up from there, and then we'll probably have an hour, half an hour of moaning about wrestling because we've been so positive in this last year, 2 hours. But no, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me again, and I'm glad that we finally got the retro half of Randy Valentine in the books.
Yes.
So whenever you decide to do a gimmick change, we'll get a third episode in. If you decide to go, I can't think of another gimmick off the top of my head.
I had an idea, but I'd like to think when I'm done with this, I'm done. But if I did do another gimmick, it would be, I would be in a complete, a grey morph suit, complete full body morph suit, and I would call myself Vacant, the most decorated champion in wrestling history. I could put As Seen on TV on the posters, popular in every wrestling game since the late 90s. I think Vacant has got a, and the merch I can do for that, easy peasy, just a bunch of grey blobs. So yeah, if I had another gimmick, I don't think I would, well, but I don't know.
So next time, right. Vacant. Vacant's going to be on. Anyway.
And I would come out to Pretty Vacant by the Sex Pistols. That would be my entrance music.
With that, right, I'm going to hit stop recording, then we can have a bit more of a chat. Right, we're out.